With Selena leading the way, we arrive at another field, this one with a gentle slope uphill away from us. We were greeted by the tall man who had guided me through the castle the night before, dressed in a grey cloak and carrying a sword and shield. He seemed very happy to see us at first, but then switched into character, grimly announcing that he was Krovac, a member of the Stonewell Order of Knights. He gestured towards a group of similarly dressed and equipped men and women, some who I recognised as monsters I had fought less than an hour ago. They explained that they were here to defeat a terrible beast that had gained the service of another race of monsters, having them terrorise the countryside. After I simply agreed that we'd help them, Hargill and Lith continued to talk to him in character, giving me a chance to take a better look at the Stonewell Knights. There were only six of them, but the four that didn't have helmets I knew to be some of the better fighters amongst the monsters. These were the ones I was glad that my sword was well over a foot longer in regards to reach than their clubs, as I exploited this fact rather than having to meet them on equal terms. After Hargill had finished a rather long-winded speech about noble duties, Krovac asks if we had any plans. Lilith asked what exactly it was that we were facing, and Krovac explained that he said a scout had reported to him. At the edge of this clearing would be the monster, surrounded by his servants. These monsters, the shambling, black-robed club wielders that he called Sheshniks, were monsters that only listened to the strongest creature they knew, and the beast was strong enough to have become their master. As if explaining it to a child, Krovac said that we didn't need to kill all the Sheshniks. We just needed to defeat the beast. While I wanted to say that this point was obvious, we didn't exactly have a great record on taking the easy and intelligent route. Agreeing that we should focus on killing the beast, I asked how he thought we should do this. He proposed a simple plan, where a larger group would bait the Sheshniks away from the beast, and a smaller unit of two or three people would strike at it directly. Hargill quickly suggested that he be the one to fight the beast, since he was the strongest person present. Lilith shook his head, saying that he was only strong as long as he had several people in front of him. Krovac said that he would like his lieutenant to be a part of the unit, and that I should be the one to accompany him. I tried to figure out a way to tell him that this was only my second event without breaking character. I ended up just saying I wasn't experienced as Lith or Hargill. The two of them quickly agreed, but Krovac said that speed would be the most important factor, and I looked the fastest. I knew that was shoddy reasoning, and that he had some other purpose behind suggesting me, but I think at that point I had started to learn that it was sometimes better to just let the people behind the quests make the decisions. I agreed to this plan, and I was introduced to Krovac's lieutenant, one of the men in helms. My eyes widened as I realised who it was. The monster leader himself, one of the three plot masters, stared at me from beneath his helmet, and I knew very well that this was not just a coincidence. He seemed to recognise my little epiphany, but he said nothing beyond this greeting, an abnormally serious look in his face. The other eight were lining up, a solid formation of six warriors in front of Hargill and Selena. The monster leader and I moved behind them, a sort of rear guard. We began to march forward up the slope, until a large group of Sheshniks came out of the woods at the edge of the field. I stared at them as they ran towards us, looking for the person who was the beast. He was unmistakable, wearing a werewolf mask and bright blue robes. He was carrying a sword and shield I knew I'd seen before. Before I could point him out to the monster leader, I saw another man wearing a werewolf mask, this one in bright red, and carrying a Bec de Corbin that I knew could not belong to anyone but one man. Finally, a man dressed in white, with a white furred werewolf mask, emerged from the forest, carrying two small daggers. I had not been told that there were three beasts. My assumption was that there would be one, and he would be the same spell-eating monster we had started this quest to find. Glancing at the old man next to me, I realised that he was observing me carefully, watching for my reactions. I frowned, not bothering to hide my mounting worry, especially since I knew this would not be an easy battle. The blue and white wolf stayed towards the back, but the red wolf marched forward with a group of Sheshniks, colliding with the shield line we had formed. The clubs of the Sheshniks slammed futilely into the shields of the knights, but the hammer of the red wolf sought and fought gaps, striking for 10 damage. I watched it first, surveying the entire battle while the old man surveyed me. The red wolf, the same man who had been playing the plated warrior the night before, was being hit again and again by the swords of the knights and by Hardjal's 10 damage fire spell, but didn't seem to care in the slightest. As he dropped the knight in front of him and the others had to close the gap, I began to wonder if he was invincible. No, if he were invincible, he would have broken through the shield wall by now, ignoring the rest of the battle. I focused on him, watching his movements carefully. He did care about the swords, though only at certain times. He would take a few hits without hesitation, but then suddenly back off, just out of the knight's range, keeping his distance until something, before he'd rush forward again, take a few hits, then move back. His health must have been regenerating. That was the only explanation. But the sheer logistics nightmare of having regeneration based on time in LARP ruled that kind out. Looking to see who was around him, I saw no Chestniks that were casting spells, and neither he nor the other wolves looked like they were casting anything either. How was he healing? What was the trigger? Then he did something that betrayed the secret. He had backup, striking and blocking carefully, which meant his HP must have been low. Hardjal threw a beanbag, a wild toss that wouldn't have hit him had the wolf stayed where he was. With obvious intent, he stepped onto the spell, and the red wolf then moved forward once again. It was so obvious. A spell-eating monster. If I was right, the wolf was healing from getting hit by spells, which meant that Hardjal was acting as his personal pet mage. Hardjal hadn't noticed, nor had Lith or any of the knights, too focused on fighting to make sense of the situation. With Hardjal just about to cast another spell, I shouted at him, telling him to stop. Hardjal looked at me as if I had told him to stop breathing. Shouting that the wolf was healing from his spells, I moved forward, intent on entering the battle. Hardjal's jaw dropped slightly, and he stopped casting spells altogether as the old man grabbed my shoulder, asking me where I was going. I told him I had something to settle, and he released me. The red wolf, having seen me shouting at Hardjal, started to fight cautiously, but was still a degree more capable than the knights in front of him. Striking with the reach of his hammer polearm, he dropped another knight, and Lith edged over to close the gap. I could feel Lith's fury from behind him. As one of the people who's beaten him before, I knew that he had a way of holding terrible grudges. He blocked the blows from the red wolf's hammer with such ferocity that he was slamming his shield into the knights that were on his side, who moved quickly out of the way. Soon there was enough space on either side of Lith for a Chestnik to rush past, but none dare tried. The red wolf's hammer was swinging with a similar ferocity, preventing anyone to get close to either him or Lith. The red wolf was probably wondering why he wasn't having as easy as a time as he had the night before. Each of his attacks, clever from my point of view, being deflected by Lith's shield. Things were different this time. Lith was using his favourite weapons. Weapons that he had trained almost exclusively with. More importantly, he had just been through a gauntlet of battles, harsher than he had ever experienced. And thinking he was the same person he had been yesterday would be the Red Wolf's second worst mistake. His first would be not paying attention to me. As much as I'm sure Lith wanted to fight him alone, he wasn't the only one with a score to settle. Though Lith was blocking each attack, he wasn't scoring any hits himself, and the gap between their skills wasn't something that could be overcome within a day, no matter how difficult that day was. Moving in beside him, he bumped his shield into me before Lith realised I was there. Though the battle had only been going on for a few minutes, he was already breathing hard. As he looked at me, I was surprised to see him smile, a wordless acceptance of my help. With the red wolf's next attack, Lith trapped the hammer between his sword and the shield, preventing the wolf from pulling it back. The opening created, I stepped in, my sword a dizzying blur as I struck at his arms and legs. He pulled at his hammer while I landed blow after blow, but Lith's arms trembled with the force he was exerting to keep the hammer where it was. With a blow to his hands that was perhaps harder than I intended it to be, he let go of his hammer, eyeing us as Lith dropped it to the ground. He began to turn around, intent on running back and perhaps getting another weapon. With a sudden flash of thought, I realised this was the perfect chance to test a theory that was eating into my mind. Digging into my pocket for the first time this event, I called out my ice spell, as I threw the beanbag at him, hitting him squarely in the back. The spell's effect worked. His legs froze, and he stood where he was, confirming my suspicions. The red wolf may have healed from the fire damage, but ice magic worked normally against him. Lith rushed forward, striking the wolf in the back several times before he finally fell over, defeated. Lith didn't even have a chance to give a shout of triumph, as a swarm of Chesniks pushed him back to the line of the knights. Thanks to Selena, the knights were getting back up after only a few seconds of healing, restoring the shield wall. I was rather happy to see that when she wasn't healing someone, she was also casting spells, and the Chesniks, a step forward from her pet mage days. While I watched her, glad to see that she was having fun, a hand clasped my shoulder. Turning to the monster's leader, he pointed at the blue and white wolves in the distance, telling me not to forget about them. Momentarily embarrassed, I thanked him without thinking, and he gave a small smile before returning to his expression of intense observation. Wondering why he didn't join in the shield line, I surveyed the battlefield once again. The Chesniks were moving in small waves, dying rather quickly as they reached the shield wall, but simply respawning behind where the blue and white wolves were standing. I watched, not sure what I was waiting for, until it happened. A perfect, clear path. The Chesniks had bunched together on one side of the clearing, unintentionally providing a direct line to the two wolves. Whether I could cover that distance before they realised I was up to chance, but I didn't know if I could wait for another opportunity. The monsters had time on their side, probably with another set of infinite lives, while we were almost entirely relying on Selena to keep us alive. Quietly, so that only he heard, I simply said, "Now," to the monster leader, before stepping past the shield line. For a moment, I must have blended in with the monsters who were returning to respawn, but the manner in which I was sprinting at full speed quickly revealed me. To my surprise, the old man was not far behind me, sprinting nearly as fast as I was. A single Chesnik managed to intercept me, but I didn't even bother with a proper duel. I moved as if just to pass him, but as he shifted to block me, I struck him once with my sword before continuing past him, leaving him alive. I heard the monster leader call out damage behind me, and I knew I wouldn't have to worry about that particular monster. Only the two wolves were in front of me. The white wolf remained towards the back, but the blue wolf moved forward, his familiar shield held in front of me. The Chesnik stopped moving towards us, creating a wide circle around the four of us, some of them even pausing to watch. The blue wolf whipped off his mask, revealing the face I had been expecting. Last time, I had defeated him while he had been a player and I a monster. It looked like he was intent to return the favour. He had removed the mask to prevent it from being a disadvantage, fully intending to do everything he could to defeat me. He rushed forward, his shield leading the way once again. He moved more cautiously this time, not wanting a repeat of the last battle. He punched forward with his shield, a few of the Chesniks gasping as he received it on the shoulder. The monster leader made a muffled noise, as if he had stopped himself from saying something, but I managed to dodge out of the way of the following sword, something I had been unable to do last night. The blue wolf seemed genuinely surprised by my dodge, but not enough to stop attacking me. He thrust his shield forward again, and without hesitation, I twisted to the side, thrusting out my hip towards the bottom of his shield while pulling my torso back. Matrix, nigga. The blow was slightly lessened thanks to the padding provided by the beanbags in my pocket, but it still hurt a lot more than I expected. The effect was worth the pain. However, as the bottom of his shield slammed painfully into his knee, and his follow-up sword attack didn't come, I filled the pause with my own attack, striking him hard on his exposed shoulder. The momentum mine, I kept attacking, my sword striking at his legs and at his arms when he chose to expose it. While last time I had been with two shorter swords, my reach with a two-handed sword was too long for him to reach me with a shield bash. I started to cut through his HP rapidly, panic starting to form on his face. He leapt backwards, muttering curses at me, and I could see that he was frustrated beyond measure. I grinned, knowing full well I was prepared for whatever he threw at me, except perhaps his shield. I don't think it's necessary for me to point out just how illegal of a maneuver this was. Did he just throw his shield at him?
Sounds like it, yeah.
What a dick. I don't think he cared in the slightest. Ignoring all the witnesses around us, he flung his shield at me, giving a bark of a shout as he threw it. It raced towards me at speed that might have seriously hurt me if he had struck me in the head.
Fucking Captain America or something.
Which he had been aiming for. I blocked with my sword, the force of the shield whipping it to the side, leaving me exposed. There were a few shouts coming from around us, but neither of us paid attention to them. He snapped. He rushed forward, sword in both hands, intent on bringing it down on my head. There was no time to block with my sword. Bringing up my left arm, I received the blow on it, a sharp pain coursing through it. He looked at me triumphantly for a brief moment.
What a fucking dickhead.
I know. Before striking at my arm again and again, calling out 6 points of damage each time. Rolling to the side out of his reach, I turned to face him, holding up my arm, which stung a fair bit from the force of his blows. I simply said, "Bracers," wiping away his smile. I marched forward, kicking his shield further away from him. He tried going towards it, but I stopped him with a hard blow to his side. He tried an attack with his sword, but I accepted the strike on my left forearm, delivering a one-handed hit with my right. Standing between him and his shield, I kept delivering blows, until he finally slumped down onto his knees, frustration etched onto his face. For a moment, I felt sorry for him, but as I felt a twinge of pain from my left arm, that moment passed. The monster leader, who had merely watched this entire time, looked as if he had something to say to me, but he kept unnaturally quiet. The white wolf had likewise done nothing but stare at us, but it was far more unnerving considering his mask. With a deep, growl-like voice that sounded familiar, but I just couldn't match because of the distortion, he requested a duel against me, his daggers in both hands. My silence being my agreement, we rushed at each other. I swung my sword at him, but he didn't even bother blocking, taking the blow then striking me for 4 points of damage with one of his daggers. I jumped backwards, swinging again, but he accepted the hit without flinches, his daggers flashing towards me. I was ready this time, and managed to block with my left hand. He didn't seem at all surprised, though I could not be certain because of the mask, and he continued his attack, forcing me back. Again and again I hit him, but he didn't seem to even mind. My sword was ineffective against him, or possibly even healing him. Digging into my pocket, I fished out a beanbag, calling out my ice spell. He didn't even try to dodge, and he didn't stop moving towards me even after the spell hit him. I made the guess that my fire spell would just be as ineffective, though I cast the one damage one at him just to be sure. Whether he was immune to fire damage or a single point of damage didn't matter to him, I couldn't tell, since he just ignored it as he had with all my other attacks. He hit me again for another 4 points of damage before I could raise my sword to block, and I realised what I needed now was time to think. My sword was almost useless defensively against him, since he wasn't worried about getting hit and his daggers were far faster. Dropping my sword, I blocked his next attack with my right forearm, and his next with my left. He seemed amused, pausing a moment to consider what I was doing, before launching into another series of attacks. That brief pause triggered my memory, and bits and pieces of this man's style began to seem familiar. After a particularly fast strike that hit me squarely in the chest before I managed to block, I recognised him. Fighting Rend was usually hard enough, but fighting Rend when none of your attacks worked was a thought that would have given me nightmares had I been insane enough to think it up before. With only a handful of HP left, I remembered that I still had 3 healing spells left, and that now was probably a good time to use one. My brain stopped at that thought. I'm sometimes dense, I'll admit. The red wolf reversed the effects of fire magic. I'm sure that blue wolf would have reversed the effects of ice spells had someone bothered to cast them at him. And there was a white wolf, seemingly immune to weapons and offensive magic. I blocked his next attack with my left arm, then lashed forward with my right, grabbing his wrist. His momentary shock gave me the moment I needed to shout out the incantation as fast as I could, casting one of the healing spells through my touch. The effect was unreasonably dramatic. Rend leapt back, screaming as if my touch had burned him through his arm. His acting, which was somewhat overzealous, unnerved me slightly, but I had more important concerns. Rushing up to him, I grabbed his arm, casting my second healing spell, trying to heal him once again. This time he didn't scream, he simply fell over, silent. The Sheshniks were muttering amongst themselves, the clubs no longer raised. Most were looking at me, grinning wildly, and I sheepishly grinned back. The monster leader, who had watched the entire fight silently, congratulated me with a simple, "Well done," before turning towards the rest of the Stonewall Knights, who were making their way towards us, the Sheshniks allowing them to pass unobstructed. Lith was smiling, while Hardgil had a stony, neutral look, as if this had been a Pyrrhic victory to him. Selena looked concerned, but cheered up considerably when I told her that no one had gotten hurt, and that Rend was simply a good actor. In truth, I think I deserved that title a little more than he did. My arms and hands in considerable pain, but with me managing not to raise anyone's concerns. The quest took time to resolve itself. The questmaster asked us if we looted anything, and we found a unique ring on each of the wolves. She then went on to say that the Sheshniks now seemed to revere us. Furthermore, she said that the knights had something to discuss with us. There was a brief moment where it looked like the blue wolf was going to be reprimanded for his dangerous fighting, but if it happened, it didn't happen near us. He left with the rest of the monsters, leaving us with the six knights. Krovac explained the history of the Stonewall Knights, a rather interesting story that nevertheless I didn't see the point in telling us. They were now issued with the task of defeating a terrible evil that had begun to plague the land, the Lich Ulsic.
Ooh, we're getting into it now,
I must have misheard him. Somehow my thoughts and desires had started to play around with my hearing. The idea that these people were planning on doing what I had come here to do was just too good to be true, even if they were just NPCs who had probably disappeared just as the quest ended. The monster leader then asked the rest of the knights to leave, which they did somewhat reluctantly. Then, dropping all pretenses, he began to address us by our real names and asking us to keep this conversation private. I agreed quickly, and the old man began to explain, slowly at first, but he began to talk faster and faster as he grew impassioned. Ulsic had started off as a partial owner of this LARP, but he had made a mess of the finances he had been in charge of, to a degree that could be called embezzling.
Ooh.
The other two owners discovered this only a few months ago, but decided to pity the man. They decided not to pursue legal action, in exchange for Ulsic paying the rent and bills he had been siphoning out of the other two's profits, as well as relinquishing his ownership. In addition to this, all his work as a plot master had been centred solely around his character, a stubborn, miserable man who would take advantage of people's kindness and pity. His influence on the game had always been a negative one. Ulsic had always taken an interest in governing the players, and under his influence and by his invitation, he had gathered people that the monster leaders were just disgusted with. The only reason that the monster leader had tolerated him to begin with was because he had been an owner, but now there was absolutely no reason for him to remain. As he talked, I began to understand why there was such a distinct difference between the players and the monsters. Still, I didn't understand what the old man was planning to do by telling us all this. He continued, explaining that this quest was something he, Vlaine, and a number of other monsters had discussed, late into last night. He had written it up rapidly, and he apologised for his sloppy nature, but he needed us to complete it for a very specific reason. Turning towards me, he said he had heard the accounts of the monsters who had fought me in the woods. He himself remembered the battle where Ulsic had died, and how the four of us had each taken part. He knew that Ulsic hated us, and hated me especially. He paused. He looked guiltily away from us for a moment, before looking back. He confessed, saying that he hated Ulsic. He hated him so much that he wanted to ruin him in the worst way he possibly could. The only reason he allowed Ulsic to resurrect was for the pure and simple pleasure of having him get killed once again by the people he hated the most. He wanted an excuse, and during the night, he had settled upon this quest as a plan. The four of us, the people with pain Ulsic the most, would lead the monsters and the Stonewall Knights against the players, like one of the ordinary large battles. However, our goal and intent would be to kill Ulsic in such a way that he would never want to return again. But, in regards to the monsters, he didn't simply want to force them to follow us, just for the sake of his own petty revenge, but to have us earn the respect with our own skill and ability, something he had faith we could do. Looking at me, he said, without any hesitation or embarrassment, that he thought I had the best sense of battle he had ever seen, though he admitted he hadn't seen all that many people in battle, and that I lacked practice, skills and techniques. I had earned the respect of the monsters in my very first event, and now that respect had only deepened. Too embarrassed to reply, I simply remained quiet as he explained to Lith his strengths, notably his desire to defend his friends, and his even stronger desire to defeat his enemies. He pointed out to Selena that she was probably the prettiest girl at the LARP, and needn't have done anything to earn anyone's admiration, though now after proving herself in two intense battles, she had earned their respect as well. To Hargill, he said that he had one of the strongest characters in the game. After dishing out a few more compliments, ones he delivered with almost frightening honesty, the old man took a moment to look at us, and he smiled a tiny smile. He wanted us to make this Ulsic's last event. He knew Ulsic had wronged us. He had wronged many people in the past. This was his. This was our. This was their revenge. We would give him a memory that he would hate and pray that he could forget. But he never would. It wasn't necessary for any of us to voice our shared agreement. I simply asked what his plans were and how we could help.